last presentation, and as already was explained, I did my thesis on the spatiotemporal evolution of a newly created muscle bed and its effect on benthic communities, also for the Ghostbusters Consortium, just as Peter done at VLIS. So Ghostbusters Consortium consists out of three partners in the industry, Jan de Nul, Demi and Siyun, and together with two research institutes, ILVO and VLIS, together they aim to create nature-inspired solutions for an ecosystem-based coastal management. And why is this needed? Well, because our conventional hard engineering structures, such as seawalls or dikes, are not considered sustainable anymore to protect our coasts from coastal hazards, from coastal erosion. And therefore, there's a need for a more nature-based solution, a more sustainable solution. And biogenic reefs, which are biological barriers built by ecosystem engineers, might be the solution. So I will just repeat what Peter said a little bit. In Coastbusters 1, the pilot project, they explored three different biobuilding species. The first one was the seagrasses and seaweed reefs. Then the second species was the sand mason worm to build reefs. And then the third species were blue mussels in order to build these reefs. And this was done by adopting a typical mussel aquaculture technique. As Peter explained, they collect mussel spat. Once mussels become too heavy, they drop on the floor and start forming a mussel bed. And additionally, some hard substrates were also put on the seabed to facilitate this reef formation. But of course, if you try to create such a reef in a subtidal and soft sediment environment, there are a lot of external challenges. For example, you have hydrodynamic forces that can completely wipe out or destroy your mussel beds, such as storms, waves, tidal currents. But there's also predation that might limit this mussel bed development, as also a lack of recruitment. But on the other hand, creating such a mussel bed will create extra habitat for other animals, such as epibenthic invertebrates that find food there and so on. And on the other hand, by filter feeding plankton from the water column, they will biodeposit feces and pseudofeces in the sediment and therefore enrich the sediment, which can also affect infaunal communities. So, therefore, this thesis was put into two parts, so two objectives. The first one was more to describe the spatiotemporal development of the mussel beds. So it was hypothesized that these dropper lines and the hard substrate bags would facilitate the mussel bed development, and that external factors such as wave action and predation would be two limiting factors when creating such a mussel bed on a soft bottom. And then the second part of my thesis was to analyze the effects of this newly created mussel bed on the macrobenthic communities. So therefore, it was hypothesized that the mussel bed would have an effect on the macrobenthic density, the diversity, and also the species composition. Over to the material and methods. So the reef was set up parallel to the coastline with a 50-meter long long line and initially 48 vertical dropper lines that functions as a substrate for this mussel spat. And additionally, 36 hard substrates were also put on the bed, as you can see here, either filled with mussel shells or stones to facilitate this bed development. And this was all done in the Belgian part of the North Sea, southwest, 2 kilometers in front of the Panne. And this was done at the leeward side of a broersbank, so rather sheltered in a gully called Het Potje. The macrobentos itself was sampled with a Van Veen grab, and this was done according before-after control impact approach. So as you can see here on this map, in the middle you have the reef site with 9 sampling stations, but there was only 1 replicate per sampling station per sampling campaign. And then we had 2 control sites at the west and the east side of this reef site, with also 2 sampling stations, but only 1 replicate per sampling station. And this was done 5 times. So once before the installation of the dropper lines and four times after the installation of the dropper lines. I have to note, for the statistical analysis, the control sites were considered as one site, otherwise the statistical analysis could not have been possible with only two samples. So in order to assess the spatiotemporal variability of the mussel beds, seven video surveys were undertaken in the reef site itself, and this was done of the dropper lines over a 1 year and a half time period. But as Peter said, this was done without a uniform video protocol, so no quantifiable data could be extracted from these videos, and therefore a more qualitative approach was chosen, where the presence of the mussels was described as their spatial organization under the dropper lines, and a semi-quantitative approach was chosen, where epifaunal species seen in the videos were categorized in some kind of very chosen abundance classes. So over to the results of the first objective was the description of the spatiotemporal development of the mussel beds. So in the Van Veen samples, mussel spat was also found, and it was very clear that when analyzing these mussel spats, we saw that there was a peak in the first summer after the installation of the dropper lines, especially when comparing this to the summer 2017, when mussel spat had a much lower density. And this clearly indicates or proves that the dropper lines positively affected this local mussel recruitment in the area. And this was also seen in the video surveys itself, because out of the seven video surveys, only in September 2018, October 2018, and August 2019, really extensive mussel beds were observed. So that means that between August 2018 and April 2019, these mussel beds completely disappeared, just to return again somewhere between June and August 2019, and then again disappeared somewhere between August and December 2019. So this clear seasonal pattern, the seasonal variability, indicates that these extensive mussel beds completely disappeared during the winters. And that might be due to the higher wave action, the winter storms that are accompanied with the winter season. And this has also been seen in previous studies, for example, in the Wadden Sea, with intertidal and also subtidal mussel beds, where they completely disappeared after a cold and stormy winter. So when looking at the spatial organization of the mussel beds, we saw, for example, here in September, that you had very extensive beds, but only on the sediments. And here in October, the mussels formed some layers on the bags filled with stones itself. But then here in August 2019, we could compare between the sediment and the bags. And I chose this picture because you clearly see that the mussels start forming beds on the edges of the bags and on sediment, but not really on the bags itself. So based on these visual observations, it's hard to say that they clearly preferred bags as a substrate. But this might be the case because when mussels fall directly from the dropper lines, they have a higher chance, of course, of falling on the sediment itself and not on the bags. And then they start forming a mussel bed, some clumps, and the mussel spat in the water column will then rather settle in on these adult mussel clumps than on just some hard substrate. So this could be a possible explanation. Also, epifaunal species were seen on the videos, and 13 different taxa were identified. And from these 13 taxa, 8 are known to feed on blue mussels. Of course, they don't feed all primarily on blue mussels, some just opportunistically, but based on literature research and their observed abundances in the videos, the shore crab, the common starfish, and the green sea urchin were identified as predators that could have a possible high impact on the mussel survival and therefore limit the mussel bed development. Especially here with the starfishes, as you can see in all these pictures, they were very abundant and clustered all around these mussel patches. So these will need to be monitored more closely in a future Coastbusters projects, and possible mitigation measures and sustainable ones can be taken against these predators. So over to the second part of my thesis, so the analysis of the effects of the mussel bed on macrobentic communities. So the macrobental's density, the species richness, Shannon index, and Simpson index were all calculated and analyzed, but because we had very few samples, we took the sampling campaigns as a repeated measures, so this could not be, or the differences between the sampling campaigns could not be statistically analyzed. But based on visual observations or just looking at the graph, you see just a clear seasonal variability with the highest values in the summer months and the lowest values in the spring months, which just shows the annual cycles that happen in the informal communities and don't really show a clear effect or a clear before-after effect, as we had hoped. But differences between the control and the reef site could be statistically analyzed. And from our linear mixed models, the Shannon-Wiener and Simpson index showed significant differences between the control and the reef sites. And especially here in the last two sampling campaigns, you see that the values for the reef site have, the indices for the reef site have lower values. As these indices also incorporate evenness, this might be a first indication that there's a shift in a macrobentic community towards macrobentic community that's more dominated by some opportunistic species that thrive in these enriched sediments, enriched environments, as also have been seen in other papers when looking at the effect of mussel beds on macrobentic communities. And then when looking at the community compositions and SIMPR analysis, even though the SIMPR analysis gave a low average dissimilarity between the control and the reef sites, oligochaetes contributed most to this dissimilarity, and they were slightly more abundant in the reef sites, as you can see here, and also in the graphs. So again, this might corroborate these previous indications or this previous hypothesis that there might be, the first indications of a shift towards a macrobentic community that's dominated by, for example, here these oligochaetes who thrive in these enriched environments. But regardless of these first results, there was an overall limited effect of the mussel bed on the macrobentals, and this might be because the control sites were very closely located to the reef site, only 50 meters away, and they could also have experienced some effects of the whole bivalve reef. And on the other hand, as we've seen in the videos, the mussel bed itself showed the seasonal variability. It was not there the whole year round. So therefore, it might also have had a limited effect on the macrobentic communities. So to conclude this thesis, based on the Van Veen samples and the mussel bed found therein, and the video surveys, it seemed that the dropper lines positively influenced the local mussel recruitment and benefited the mussel bed developments. But the mussels didn't seem to show a clear preference for the bags as a substrate. And also based on the seasonal variability seen in the mussel beds and the many predators also found on the mussel beds, these are possible limiting factors, and they will be needed monitored more closely in future Coastbusters projects. And then finally, overall, the mussel bed had a limited effect on underlying macrobentic communities. But of course, longer term observations might give more and better results. Before concluding, I would like to do some recommendations because we had a very small sampling size, no extensive statistical analysis could be done. So therefore, if more samples could be taken per site and per sampling stations, more statistical analysis can be done. I would also stick with the multiple control sites still, but they should be located further away. And maybe to not have the seasonal variability, a fixed sampling campaign and time might also be chosen. And of course, the longer term observations might also give better results. And then for the video surveys, in order to really extract quantifiable and reproducible data, a video transect protocol was proposed where the multiple fixed video transect in the reef sites can be done, where the density and the surface area of the mussel bed can be quantified, as also benthic macroinvertebrates can be quantified, and additionally some photoquadrats can be taken, so muscle conditions and epibionts can also be analyzed to give a more holistic overview of this spatial-temporal variability of the mussel beds. So thank you for your attention. I would like to thank my supervisor.